Is investment something that's always been on your mind, but you don't quite know how to get started on that journey? We are here to set you on the right course. Welcome to My Cashflow Academy's Investor's Corner with your host, Athena Paquette Cormier. We are all about getting out of the rat race through creating positive passive income through real estate investing. Here you'll hear from regular people just like you and the professionals who support us towards greater wealth. Learn before you earn. Move from analysis to action and find the right path to attaining the success that you've always dreamed of for yourself. Now, here's your host, Athena.
Hi, I'm Athena Paquette, and welcome to our first ever Investor's Corner. If you're new to investing, you'll learn the steps that real-life investors use to achieve financial freedom. And if you're a seasoned investor, then you'll discover something you didn't know. I know after 23 years as an investor, I'm always learning something new. I decided to do this show because I meet so many would-be investors who are fearful of investing and don't know the steps to get started, and so they stay stuck. I'm here with Renee Riker, and she is an investor I've known for quite a few years now, and I invited her here to talk about her investing style, the steps she took, and share some of her wisdom with you. Hi, Renee.
Hello. Thanks for having me.
So I wanted to start by asking you, when you first got an inkling that you wanted to invest in real estate, when did that light bulb go off?
Oh, I would say probably around 1996 or so. That's the first time I actually started active investing. The primary driver was my husband works in aerospace, and I knew it was not a secure situation with the amount of layoffs happening. So I wanted to have a plan B and supplement my income.
Mm-hmm. And so what was the first thing? What was your first step? Was it a class? Was it a book?
No, the very first step actually was when I wanted to relocate so my girls could go to a different high school. Mm. So we were living in a home that I didn't want to sell because it was upside down. So I invested, I started renting that out. That was my very first experience. But then I went on after that in 2004 and bought a single family home in Chandler, Arizona. And I invested about $90,000 in that property and didn't really have a clue what I was doing. I had taken a couple of classes and read a few books. The good thing was that appreciation, it gained about $100,000 within 2.5 years, but the cash flow wasn't really there throughout that time. So I would never recommend going for appreciation. I would definitely go for cash flow, but in the end, that one worked out.
Mm. And so you sold that one?
Yes.
And you reinvested the money? Or?
Yes. We bought 3 single-family homes in Oklahoma at that time with that money.
Mm-hmm.
And I still have those, and those do produce cash flow.
Mm-hmm. So after that appreciating property, you decided, did you already want cash flow at that point?
Yes. That's okay. What I was going for, that passive income or mailbox money, as you call it.
Right. Okay, good. And so how do you like, why did you choose Oklahoma?
Well, I was going for the Kiyosaki 1% principle, where I wanted 1% of the rents to be 1% of the purchase price. Mm. And I couldn't find that in California at the time. So I just literally started interviewing property managers across the country saying, hey, what's your typical 3-bedroom go for? And, you know, what do you recommend? What neighborhoods? And so I do a lot of research through property managers to figure out where I want to purchase. Mm. But anyway, that's how I ended up in that area.
Oh, that's interesting. So interviewing the people who are actually managing property.
Yes.
Oh.
That's okay. What I do. Yes.
That's awesome.
I don't go straight for the realtors typically.
Mm-hmm. And so what is Kiyosaki principle?
Well, so his is passive income. And so when I said the 1% principle, meaning, you know, what your price point should be compared to what the rents are. So that's how I started. And then I read a lot of his books and did some of his coaching programs and so forth.
Robert Kiyosaki, you mean?
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Wonderful. Okay. And so how much time does it take you to think about your investing? How much time would you say you invest in the learning process of investing?
Well, early on, because I do two different forms of investing. So I do single family rental homes, and I'm also a dirt flipper. So I flip dirt like some people flip homes. Mm. So it's completely different. So on the home side, once I figured out where I wanted to buy, then it's really a matter of being able to manage the property manager, so to speak. So the research that I did up front was, you know, what are the rents, what types of properties, what location. Once the homes are purchased, then it's just a matter of managing the manager and making sure you have good escape clauses to get out of your management agreement if you need to, which I have several times. But for the land, it's a completely different process. So I had to learn. I spent a lot of time up front learning because it was something new to me. I needed to do the due diligence on the properties that I was going to purchase, you know, so there was a lot of learning up front.
Okay, so I'd love to hear more about that in a second. So where else do you own single families? And you mentioned Oklahoma, and where else?
Also in Texas, three in Texas, and we sold the one in Chandler, Arizona. Mm. We did have another one in California that I sold recently. Mm. And that's it.
Okay.
For the homes.
So do you have a plan to sell all of them or keep them? I've heard some people are buy and hold and some people are just trying to get better and better cash flow, right?
Well, I'd actually want to always probably hold some because I want that passive income. Mm-hmm. Where those are, I don't know. They may shuffle around, but I'm hoping to always hold some for passive income. That's the whole point.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So you have a full-time job?
Yes.
You do this part-time?
Yes, okay. I have a full-time job. I've had almost 25 years for an automotive company. Mm-hmm. And so, yes, I do all of this part-time. So
wow.
You have to be kind of driven to do this part-time, but I do it because it's really my passion.
Mm-hmm. And what other personality characteristics or talents do you have that you think make you successful in real estate or got you to be successful?
I would say being very tenacious and not being afraid to ask questions when you don't understand something. Mm-hmm. I really don't have a background or from family anyway of anybody investing in real estate. So I kind of had to do it on my own, just seek things out by reading or asking different people in the areas that are fellow real estate investors, 10 different conferences. I've taken lots and lots and lots of training classes, some good, some not so good. Spent lots and lots of money doing that, thousands of dollars.
Well,
yeah. So
being tenacious.
Yes. So just being tenacious and not really being afraid to ask questions and dig in and apply. You can't just stop at reading. You have to actually do.
Mm. And I know you as a pretty detailed person. So do you think that helped you in your investing? Or do you think that was more of a stumbling block or some kind of block, like being too detailed?
Sometimes it can take you longer to make a decision if you're too detailed, and I am very detailed and I'm very process oriented. Mm-hmm. So I think that's also helped, though, because when I have a process to follow, then I can just improve upon it along the way. So I typically build processes into everything that I do and have spreadsheets for analysis and so on and so forth.
Mm-hmm. What would you say to someone who's very analytical, who wants to invest but gets stopped by that? How do you get beyond, when is enough information enough?
That's a really good question. I think all you really can do is try to manage risk as best as possible. Mm. And I think you get to the point where you know you've got to have a gut feel of, okay, I've researched as much as I can. It's time to take the next step. Mm. You can't be paralyzed, and you have to be willing to risk something, right? Because real estate is, there's some risk of in there. So you have to figure out what you're comfortable with. The first piece of land I bought, you know, I told my husband, okay, this is $1,800. We may never sell this thing. Are you okay with the risk? Yes. Okay. So we bought that. So you just have to be willing to make a
move. Fabulous. My heart's pounding just hearing you tell that little story. Okay, well, if you'd like to call in and ask Renee questions yourself, you would call 347-308-8591. And so this is our Investor's Corner, and we're here with Renee Riker. And we have so many questions to ask you, Renee. So I'm going to ask a short one since we're coming to our break. So do you have a team? Who's on your team to create this these results?
Well, I have different business partners that I use. I have a good relationship with a realtor that I use in one area. I have a couple different title companies that I use. My daughter actually helps me research some of the properties, the good people that help me with websites and videos and so on and so forth. So it's definitely not a sole effort. So I definitely have a team to help me.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. And how involved is your spouse?
You know, this isn't really his thing. So I pretty much I take the lead on the investments, but he's very, very supportive and will help, you know, on the administrative back end if I need it. Mm-hmm. So it's pretty much me.
Yeah. Uh-huh. You're the team, huh?
I'm the team. Yeah.
Okay. So again, you're listening to Investor's Corner with Athena Paquette. That's me on Life Oasis Empowerment Radio Network. So again, you're listening to Investor's Corner with Athena Paquette on Life Oasis Empowerment Radio Network. So it's now some tough questions, right? What was the deal you wish you would have let go of? If you could press the delete button on something recent or way past, what would you do?
You know, I really don't have one of those. I can't really think of one. Land, every transaction has been successful. Rental homes, they've for the most part been pretty successful. I think maybe if I had anything to do over, would I do it different? I probably wouldn't do it different because I think I've learned along the way. So it's not really any deal that I wish I hadn't done or that I should have done.
So is there a deal maybe that you wish you would have taken action on? That you let one slip away?
None that I can think of. The only thing, generically speaking, I could say is if I had more time, because I do work full time, if I had more time to analyze more properties, like the next thing I want to go into is multifamily. So I know I've been lingering and I need to do more analysis so I can take the next step to move on to that. But nothing that I said, oh, I wish I would have bought that one. I can't think of that.
And so you mentioned you're going into multifamily now. So what does that mean?
So I want to buy plexes. So anything from like a fourplex to a small apartment building, something like that, because I'm getting towards the retirement age. So I'm wanting to kind of solidify what are my investments going to be that's going to sustain me. So I don't have to keep kind of thinking so much. I want to have something kind of nailed down. And I think that's probably the next action I need to take.
So you're thinking in terms of the income in retirement.
Correct. Right.
Okay. And do you know where you're going to invest, or do you know where that is going to be?
I don't really. I don't know yet. I'm hoping someplace in California and ideally someplace local. So if I wanted to go and visit the property myself or have my husband do handyman work, he could do that. And I know that cash flow, it's more difficult in Southern California. So you really just have to be patient and find that right property. So ideally, it would be someplace local, not out of state again.
So do you have an idea of how much income you need to create for your retirement? Do you have a number in mind?
I don't have a specific number. But I know because the variables change when I go through, okay, where do I want to retire? What are those income versus expenses going to be? So the number changes because that's not really locked down. I'm pretty confident, though, that hopefully I can retire within the next few years, though I don't have a specific number I'm targeting.
Mm-hmm. I'm sure your employer will be very sad that day. let's see. So, this may sound kind of like a funny question, but people are very fearful of investing, and I really want to get across that this is can be fun, right?
Absolutely.
So what's the most fun thing you've done? What do you find a lot of fun in investing?
Definitely the land. That's my passion. Mm-hmm. I've been doing it for about 5 years now. And there's just nothing like seeing awesome returns. I've not seen anything like it other than land. Mm-hmm. So that really gets my blood going. Whether that's I just buy a property myself and flip it mm-hmm. for profit, or where I sell it for cash or on terms where I carry the note, mm-hmm. or if it's an assignment where I'm assigning a contract to a third party buyer, and it's a win-win-win situation. It's a win for the seller, win for the buyer, and a win for me mm-hmm. for doing the matchmaking. So it's all wonderful.
So I heard you right. The fun is in the numbers.
Yes.
The numbers of the return.
Yes.
I didn't hear the dirt is so much fun. Do you go to the dirt or do you...
No, and that's another reason I really like this form of investing. I can do it anywhere, anytime, just from a laptop. So I have a lot of online tools that I use. I don't really ever have to go see the property. Mm. And it's really paper shuffling, really, in the end. That's what it is. Mm. But it's very profitable. Unique niche. Mm.
So your ability to have processes in place kind of makes that successful for you.
Yes, correct.
So if someone's disorganized, this may not be their way, or can they still do it?
It depends. Again, going back to your question about the team, if they have a team that's organized, they still could do it. Mm-hmm. So, it depends. I've kind of solely been the acquisition manager, the sales manager, the webmaster, the everything, the financier, everything. But doesn't mean it has to be that way. So I think some level of organization is good because mm-hmm. there's a lot of volume, or at least in my business, there's a lot of volume. Mm-hmm. So I have some processes in place with websites and things the way I do things, as well as some email templates that I use and templates for letters and so on and so forth.
I want to talk more about the land now, because that seems to me, from our conversations, your passion, right?
Yes.
So what kind of tools do you use in that business, in the land business itself?
Well, I use different websites to actually purchase the land for inquiries for sellers looking to sell their land. They go to one of my websites. If I'm looking to sell land, I have a different website, and I market on many, many different websites. So that's some
third party, other people's websites.
Correct.
Okay.
And then land specific websites. And then I have different analysis tools that I use, spreadsheets to figure out how much to offer type of thing. And then just your online general, realtor.com and different mm-hmm. websites to show you what properties are currently selling for or listed for to figure out value. Mm-hmm. And then I make
so
my
your
offers.
So your own spreadsheets, or are there online tools you've used for calculating? And
they're my own spreadsheets that I use, my own system.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Okay, but you're very good at spreadsheets, so hopefully there's online tools that someone can use instead of building a spreadsheet, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, good. So when you're investing in land, so what was your first land deal? Let's start with kind of the different areas of land that you've invested in, or the different types of deals you've done.
Okay, so I think the first...
And of course, we have a spreadsheet here.
Yes. Well, I can't remember all the numbers, actually.
Okay.
I'm trying to remember the very first one. Okay, the very first one, I think I mentioned earlier, it was for $1,800 was the purchase price I paid to the sellers. It was four brothers and sisters that inherited from their parents. Mm. So I paid them $1,800, but I also paid their back taxes and the closing costs. So I was into that total for about $3,600. And that's the one I told my husband, okay, this little lot up in the mountain, we may never sell it, but are you good with it? And so he said yes. So I sold it to a person for $8,500. with owner financing. And to this day, he's still, and that was back in February of 2010. He's still making his payments every month. So that was my first deal.
February 2010. Okay. And when did you start the learning process with the land business?
I started that December of 08.
So not quite, is that 2 years? Not quite.
No.
You're in a couple of months of learning and then.
Right. So, but the first year really was set up learning everything, setting up a company, learning the infrastructure, you know, learning how to research a property, setting up an 800 number. I'm really getting the business in shape and learning how to do a mail merge to send letters. It was all kinds of learning up front.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wonderful. And so that was your first deal. And you said you did owner financing. What does that mean exactly?
So
you were the owner, I guess, at that point.
Yes, correct. Okay. So I finance the property. So I collect a small down payment and then carry the note. And then I have a loan servicing company that I utilize that the buyers make their payments to, and they ACH the money to me every month.
Wow. So the buyer makes payments to this third party
company.
Call the servicer.
Yes.
And then this servicer just dumps money in your bank account?
Yes.
You said it nicely as an ACH, but that's what happens, right?
Yes.
Wow.
They charge $15 a month for this service. Very reasonable that I have my borrowers pay. Mm-hmm. And it's awesome. They do collecting. If they're late, they do all of the end of the year, you know, recording of the interest and principal. Mm-hmm. So it's really no hassle for me whatsoever. It's awesome.
Mm-hmm. So if I heard you right, you paid in $3,600 and then you turned around and sold it for $8,500.
Correct. Right.
Okay. So do you know what return that is?
With 9.9% interest.
Oh, on the payments. Okay.
On the payments. Right.
Well, better than what the bank's giving you.
Yes, correct. Yeah.
But so your return on the note is 9.9, but when they pay you back completely, you invested $3,600 and you got back the difference between $85 and $36, so about $3,900?
Right.
Plus whatever interest they paid over time.
Correct.
So is that like a 200% return?
Yes, it is.
Do you have a number?
Okay. That's exactly
my
right.
My little head was doing the math in my
You're
little
right.
head, but wow, I wanted to make sure I was understanding you. Wow. That's
but
amazing.
But my second deal was actually better than that.
Really?
My second deal, do we have time to talk
about
it?
We do have time.
Okay. So that one, again, I bought six lots that were...
All at once.
All at once from one seller. It's actually two sellers that inherited it. They were out-of-state owners that didn't want this California land, these six parcels. And I was really scared because this was a big deal for me. This was a really big deal. I had talked to a couple of different realtors in the area to try and figure out how much were these six parcels worth. It was in an area in the desert I wasn't familiar with. So I got they were worth between 100 and 200,000, big range. I wasn't really sure. So I just said, okay, I'm just going to take a stab. And I offered them 27,000. Had to use a home equity line to do that, but I bought them for 27,000.
Wow.
Within a short amount of time, the first lot I sold for 20, the second lot I sold for 40, the third lot I sold for 18, the fourth lot I think I sold for 22, and the last two I sold for 10. So I think it was about 100,000, whatever that math works out to be.
Wow.
So I was able to pay back my HELOC, and then that really got me started with investing, paid back all of my educational costs and my LLC costs and all that. So that really got me fired up. And
that's really amazing. And how long a period did it take to sell all those lots?
That's a good question. They really didn't take that long. I would think some were within the first few months, some maybe into like the year time frame.
Okay.
Yeah.
And did you ever rent them out while you were owning them, or they were just vacant land sitting vacant?
Just vacant land sitting vacant. No maintenance or anything. The only thing you have to pay, obviously, is property taxes, which is relatively low.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. So
I'm hearing twice now that these people inherited property. So do you think that's a niche, or is that a driver for people to want to sell?
I think sometimes the drivers for people wanting to sell land is they inherited it and... or they're just behind on taxes and they see land as a burden and they don't know what to do with it. So they just want to dump it and get rid of it.
So is that why they sell
Or a realtor maybe hasn't been able to sell it. Maybe it was priced too high. Could be different reasons.
Okay. So my curiosity was, why would someone sell something worth $100,000 sell it for $27,000?
Right.
So is that lack of knowledge, do you think, on their part?
I don't know if it's lack of knowledge. It could be or it could not be. And the reason I say that, I just had someone a few weeks ago contact me, knowing full well that their property was worth at least 20. And he said, I just need to sell it for $5,000 and for you to pay my taxes. That's all I need. I need it quick. They just need quick cash. So I said, okay, I can do that. So I send him the money and talked to my realtor in the area. And she said, we should be able to move that for $35,000.
Wow. That's amazing, Renee. So we talked about buying the land. But I'm wondering, how do you find these people? Could you tell us about that when we come back?
Sure.
Back to the land, Renee. So you mentioned that that you sold those few properties in under a year, 7-8 months, you were thinking?
Right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And so I see this spreadsheet, people. I can't believe it. So how many pieces of land, how many plots of land have you invested in since the very beginning now? Do you have an idea?
Oh, goodness. I haven't added them up, but I would say between buys and sells, probably 40 to 50 transactions around
Wow.
that neighborhood, something like that.
Wow. And it only in California or where were
No,
they?
Across the country, across Wow. the country.
Mm-hmm. So when you invest in other states, you have to really depend on those tools, right? Because you have no...
Absolutely.
Gut feeling
right. Or you might talk to a realtor or just information that you can research on the internet.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So you bought land that you own the actual dirt.
Right.
Right. And then do you have any that you own right now?
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And do you have a website where people can see what does this look like?
Sure. Yes. The land that I have for sale is on www.landrushnow.com.
Okay.
And I have a blog if anybody's interested in just learning what is this land investing thing.
Mm.
And I have articles there that have answered people's questions throughout the years and different tips and tricks on there and so on and so forth.
Okay. Wow. So on one website, they can see your land.
For sale.
That's for sale. Okay.
And the other is the business aspect.
I got it. Of doing the land business.
Correct.
Wow. So you've been a teacher.
I've been trying to help people.
Yeah,
yes.
That's amazing.
In
that's
my
so
spare
wonderful.
Time.
Yeah, in all your spare time.
Yes.
That's amazing. So these returns are pretty amazing.
Yes.
I'm like getting a little stuck on that now. So we had a 200% return. And then, wow. So I'll just 240, 245, 262. Well, a couple of them are a piddly 83% and 98%. That's a little sad, I suppose, but better than 0.01 that we're getting in our checking account.
Yes.
Wow. So that's amazing. So you can buy the land and resell it.
Mm-hmm.
And then you talked about being the banker.
Right.
You actually finance people.
Right.
Okay. And that sounded fairly easy because you've got a company helping you with that.
Right.
With collecting the payments.
Mm-hmm.
I know one of the big fears with investors is, what if they don't pay me? Like, how do I know they're going to pay me?
Right.
And you hear disaster stories about having to foreclose and stuff. So how many of these people end up not paying you?
Well, so far, thankfully, I haven't had that. I try to collect sufficient down payment where they've got some skin in the game.
Mm.
And thankfully, no one has defaulted yet, so I haven't had to do the foreclosure thing.
Mm-hmm.
And typically, the way I set up the loan payments is such that the down payment that I collect, I made whole within 12 to 18 months.
Oh.
And then the rest is profit after that. So I try to set the down payment up in that fashion.
Mm.
And so maybe it's because they're putting, 20 to 30% down,
mm-hmm.
that they just are less likely to default.
Mm-hmm. And why would they take your loan at 9.99% instead of just a bank loan at 4%?
Well, typically my understanding is banks don't typically like to lend on land. So mm-hmm. I kind of fill that niche.
Mm.
I'm charging actually 8.9 now. It was 9.9 when I started.
Oh, okay. That's nice of you.
Yes. So, I think just because it's very simple for them, it's there's really no qualifying involved. They're approved if they have the down payment.
Mm. So the big down payment's kind of the safety for you, but also their motivation to keep paying, right?
Right, exactly.
Okay. So Renee, I wanted to back up because I know the reason we started this radio program is because people have a lot of fear that stopped them from investing. And one of the things is like, if I become the bank, people may foreclose, right? So are you not afraid of that? Or?
Well, of course, there's a piece of it that you're afraid of that, but not so much because the way I manage that risk is the down payment that I collect. And also the loan servicing company that I use will handle the foreclosures if I need to do that. Mm-hmm. And then it's a matter of taking back the property and you keep already the money that you've collected thus far. Mm-hmm. So I don't do the really inexpensive, you know, $200 down and you're in. I don't do that. So right. I make sure I collect sufficient enough down payment that I don't have to worry about that so much.
Yeah, that makes sense. And do you think the servicer creates like a formality to it that makes them see it serious? Do you think there's a part of it? Like, because yes. Some people collect payments themselves, have it sent to their home.
Right.
They do all that themselves, right?
I definitely think that helps because it is a formal system. They can log on and make their payment. They can mail their payment. They can, you know, make their payments in different ways. And because I'm out of the loop, they're the third party handling it. It is a more formalized process.
Right. So they may take it more seriously or not try to, like with tenants, tenants often will try and push the envelope on when they send their rent or those kinds of things. So being the bank, I would think is the same risk that people might, you know, pay late or, you know, push mm-hmm. that envelope mm-hmm. too, right? So
right.
I was thinking maybe that's what it is.
I've had some late payments, mm-hmm. But they always come around so far, thankfully. Mm-hmm. I've had about 10 loans so far that I've serviced in this time.
Okay.
Two have paid off, so I think I'm down to about 8 right now.
Mm-hmm. You don't know?
I think I'm pretty sure it's 8 and it's about $1,500 a month.
I think that's a good sign that you're not too sure, right? Because it's going smoothly for you.
Right.
Yeah. That's interesting. And so are you going to continue to do land investing or is this something you want to continue doing or was this just a way to make money to buy something else?
Oh, no, absolutely. I will continue. I plan to continue doing this long term. Like I said, it's my passion. It's a great way to make lumps of money on the bulk sales to buy like the apartment complex or whatever it is I want to do, as well as reinvest in other land. Mm-hmm. And the owner financing brings that passive income that I'm looking for as well.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then, so this, these returns are pretty high. So some people might think, hey, this is a big tax problem. What do you say to people that say that's a big tax problem right there?
Well, I guess if you weren't making money, it doesn't really matter, right? You're making money. So in the end of the day, you're making money. Mm-hmm. So taxes are taxes. You got to pay them no matter what.
Mm-hmm.
So it is what it is, but I'm still making money.
So you're happy to pay the taxes because that represents
right. So
the
I'm
success.
Making money. Yeah. Right.
Okay. That's fair enough. So, because believe it or not, I've had people tell me that.
Oh, okay.
You know, which
okay.
is funny. Oh,
yeah.
I don't want to pay the tax. Oh, okay. Then
don't
better
make
not
the money.
Be successful.
Right.
Okay. So tell me about this matchmaking thing.
Okay. So you want to talk about the contract assignment. So mm-hmm. that's something that I started last year. And I'll tell you the first deal that I did, which felt really great. It was a woman who called and said that she had inherited 3 parcels of land, beachfront properties up in Northern California from her grandmother. And she was in a bad situation. She had just lost her job. Her house was in foreclosure. It was really a bad situation. And she said, I just need to sell these quick. She found me online. She said, I just need $10,000.
Wow.
Actually, she said, no, she said she needed $8,000 to $10,000 total for all 3 parcels. Mm. So I looked with my online tools. It's near $1 million homes. And I said, okay, I was going to buy them myself. Beautiful, mm. absolutely beautiful. But my research showed that they weren't buildable because it was a compromised body of water. It's where in Jenner, California, where the Russian River meets the ocean, and they weren't buildable. So, because you couldn't put a septic system or anything in there. So I told her, unfortunately, you know, they're not buildable. Your best bet would be to sell them to the neighbors. And you're welcome to do that on your own. You don't really need me for that. Or I can try and do it for you and I'll take my fee from the buyer. She said, I have too much stress. I don't want to deal with it. Just get what you can get. Wow. So I said, okay. So I actually did a contract with her for eight, one for 10 and one for 15, because I wasn't sure what I was going to get, because there really was no comparables in this unique property. So I then...
So you wrote up three different contracts.
Wrote up three contracts with her. Okay. Because I told her, I'll try and get you what I can get you. I really don't know. I'm going to have to test it. So I called the two adjacent neighbors. One happened to be a real estate attorney, the owner that owned the property next to hers, and then another lady. So I called, I left him a message at his office, said, my name's Renee Riker, I'm a real estate investor, I have a property under contract adjacent to your home. We're selling the properties for $24,000. If you're interested, call me.
Just like that. Laid it on the line. Just telephone right line. Okay.
And then 15 minutes later, he called. He said, I know exactly those properties. I was going to write a check for $50,000 a few years ago, but the seller wouldn't sell.
Wow.
So to him, he's excited because he sees an opportunity for 50% profit in his mind, right? Mm-hmm. So anyway, long story short, I ended up selling it to him. And I got the seller $15,000. He paid the $24,000. And I got a $7,000 assignment fee for matchmaking that deal.
Wow.
So not a penny out of my pocket, just a little bit of time.
Mm-hmm. And how much, because that does sound like a lot of research. And someone might say, well, how do I know that this land is not buildable? And how would I find out? So how did you find all that stuff out?
I found it out just by talking to different people that specialized in that area. Actually, in this, every case is different. In this particular case, the grandmother had worked with an agent in the area that had the properties listed years prior. So I actually went that route and talked to that agent and found out certain things and talked to the county offices, planning and zoning and so forth.
Wow. So how long did that take you to do that research? Do you remember?
Oh, just probably
an hour, a couple
maybe.
Of
hours? I mean, yeah, within a day or two, just between phone calls back and forth.
Uh-huh. Wow. That's astounding. And so what was the second? You said you've done three so far, right?
Right. Mm-hmm. The second one was a person looking to sell again. It was land he had inherited, I think, from his grandfather. And he wanted $50,000, I believe, is what he wanted for his property. And that was typically a higher price point than I was used to dealing with, because typically I would try to do assignments for cash and not do owner financing, because typically the seller wants cash, quick cash. So anyway, that one I ended up selling like within a couple of weeks of marketing it, and I got $5,000 for that one.
For just matching up this seller
with the buyer.
With the buyer.
Right.
And the buyer had cash, or
yeah.
You were just out of it? Okay.
Just had cash.
Wow.
So just turned over the contracts to the title company that I used, and they closed the deal and cut me a check at the end.
Wow. For making that matchup. Okay. And what was the third one about?
The third one, trying to remember how I got that one. Again, it was somebody I think that found me online, and that one, the seller wanted $10,000 and I got a $2,500 assignment fee and sold that one really quick as well.
Through your website?
Or? Well, I put everything on my website, but I put it on a bunch of other websites and Craigslist and LandWatch and LandFlip and different places and Postlets. So I don't remember where the lead came from, but it was one of those.
Wow.
And I also have a buyer's list that I've been building up for 5 years. So I've got about 800 people on that I send email blasts to.
Mm-hmm. Wow, that's amazing. And there, I guess there's more and more websites that you can go to, right, to find these things.
Right.
One of the things I wanted to ask you about was legal entities. Like, how do you hold your property or how do you hold your investments? Like, we all know at work, our you know, retirement money's in a thing called 401k, right? So it's in this shell. So do you have money in entities or... Like I've heard of IRAs. Have you tried doing one of these self-directed IRAs?
So both. So I have, my husband and I both invest in our 401k. Been doing that for years. But I also have a self-directed Roth IRA that I can buy real estate in and sell, and the money comes back tax-free. So I've done that once already with my self-directed Roth IRA, and I have money sitting there. Now that you remind me, I need to go buy another piece of land in that.
Yeah. Well, you're welcome. I'm glad I could remind you of that.
Yeah. So I do that as well. And then the way I take title to the properties that I own is through my company, which is an LLC.
Okay. You mean the single family homes?
No, the dirt.
The dirt.
The land.
Okay.
The land.
So the land is in an LLC. Mm-hmm. But then you also have this IRA that you're buying land in.
Right.
Okay. And so how do you hold the real estate, the single family homes? How do you hold title to those? Or what have you done over the years? I guess you've
I've done different ideas on this. Yeah, I've done different things, both taking title in our names and putting in an LLC. So, and I'm currently actually researching different structures of what's the best way to do that, because it gets very complicated. And depending on who you talk to, you get different answers all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So,
and of
I'm
course
still
you don't like
that,
that. So you're checking it out for yourself. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. So I'm researching that.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. So, back to the IRA though. So how do you buy the land in the IRA?
So there's a custodian. You don't touch the money yourself. So there's it's a third-party company, really, that the deed is put in the name of the IRA to the property.
Oh.
All bills are paid out of the name of the IRA. And then when you sell the property, the money goes back to the IRA name.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't really ever touch it. And then my understanding is, I think you can take that when you're 59 and a half.
Traditional IRA. So the money's just growing in there tax-free, I guess, right?
Correct.
Okay. Okay, and then the LLCs, you're just going to think about that and do research, right?
Yeah.
So if you had to talk about where investors find information, if you're a new investor and you just want to start learning, what would you suggest someone does?
Well, I would say try to research what you can on your own before you go spend a lot of money on expensive coaching. There's a lot of books that you can read. There's great blogs, just real estate investing blogs that you can check out.
Are there any you can think of? Or
I know yours is good.
Okay. Well, thank you.
And my friend, he has one, REITipster.com. That's a good one.
Okay. REITipster. Okay.
And then I think you really just have to figure out for yourself what you're comfortable with. Because while I can explain what it takes to do land investing from my perspective, you have, like I've told people, it's great, I love it, and I walk them through it. They're like, wow, that's great, but I could never do that. It's not my DNA. So you really have to figure out what is your comfort zone.
Okay. Well, this has been super fun. Again, you're listening to Investor's Corner with Athena Paquette, today with my guest, Renee Riker, on Life Oasis Empowerment Radio Network. If you'd like to get in contact with Renee, the real estate matchmaker, Renee, why don't you give them your information of where they could reach you? And our next show is Saturday, March 8th from 11 to 12, and we'll have another amazing guest, which is Sherry Ashman, who is the operator of a management company who will tell you all the good, bad, and ugly of property management, whether you do it yourself or you hire a manager. So be sure to go to my website or Facebook page, and the info is AthenaPaquette.com. Thank you for tuning in. I'm Athena Paquette.
This has been another episode of My Cashflow Academy's Investor's Corner with your host, Athena Paquette Cormier. We wish you all the success you deserve as you use what you've learned here out in the real world. Check out the blog post for this episode, along with many more helpful resources at MyCashflowAcademy.com.